sultry darkness was visible and crimson, like the darkness of closed eyes on a summer's afternoon. The bulging flanks of row on receding row and tier above tier of bottles glinted with innumerable rubies. The Billingham factory was set up by a businessman and politician named Sir Alfred Mond, first Baron Melchett, who would lend his name to Huxley's story as resident world controller of Western Europe, Mustafa Mond. With electric cars, helicopters, and transport systems inspired by cranes, it is progress in brave new world. One believes things because one has been conditioned to believe them. A man can smile, and smile, and be a villain. You all remember, I suppose, that beautiful and inspired saying of R. Ford's, "History is bunk. History is bunk."
Thanks. We're going to have an opportunity to ask questions and have a conversation with Claire and Doug at the end of our evening, just before we transform into the Ghost in the Shell audiovisual performance setup. But before that, we're going to have one more stop on our tour tonight. We're going to fill our guns with portal juice and open the gateways to the parallel universes of Rick and Morty with animation director and storyboard artist Douglas Einar Olsen. Douglas's cartoon animation projects include Rick and Morty season 3 and 4. Yes, there is a season 4. It's coming, apparently. Adult Swim series, Venture Brothers, and Little Big Awesome for Titmouse Animation. He specializes in cinematic storytelling, high-paced action, thought-provoking visuals, and an emphasis on strong draftsmanship. Douglas was one of the storyboard artists for the award-winning episode Pickle Rick. And tonight we're going to pull back the curtain to see what it takes to transform a personified pickle into what will surely become one of the 21st century's great cultural icons. Thanks, Doug.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. I'm really stoked to be here. This is pretty awesome. Thank you to Strelka and thank you to Liam. This is the thingy?
Yes.
Okay. Hope you guys like, thank you. hope you guys like cartoons, because I've worked on a lot of them, largely as a storyboard artist, sometimes as a director. As Liam mentioned, I'm currently storyboarding on Rick and Morty season 4, so I can't talk about that, but I will be talking about season 3 a little bit. These are some of the shows I've worked on. My first job, just a little quick backstory, I started off on a show called The Venture Brothers, which I'm not sure if it airs here. I brought it up a few times and people don't know what I'm talking about, but it's a really great kind of action satire, and I actually came into it as a background artist. These are some of the backgrounds I worked on for it. It's kind of a throwbacky retro kind of show, a lot of vintage kind of electronics, weird villain lairs, things like that. Very kind of stylish, which is a lot of fun. I don't paint these backgrounds, by the way. In animation, television animation, there's a lot of subdivision of labor. So as a background designer, in this particular show, I would do entirely like a grayscale rendering of an environment, which would then be handed off to a paint team. And the paint team would then make it look beautiful and TV ready like this. This was kind of the crown jewel of that period. This is a supervillain nightclub called Don Hell's, built inside of a missile silo. This was kind of like pretty big undertaking, as you can probably tell. It's a little bit dark, but it's these sets that you're designing for animation, they're sort of like stages. You have to be able to stage scenery in there. You have to have characters be able to enter and exit the screen. A lot of times, these wide shots, not only do they serve as like a map for other painters to kind of know what an environment is supposed to look like, if, say, it has to be illustrated from another angle, but you also want to get a lot of mileage out of this if, say, you want to shoot a wide shot, but then there's enough detail on that bar down here that if you zoomed in on it, you could have some folks sitting there. But I really wanted to storyboard. The design team had openings at the time. The storyboard team did not. But while I was on the show, I sort of was bugging them to be like, hey, can you try me out on storyboards? And eventually they relented and let me give it a shot as a revisionist, which is the entry-level position in television as a storyboard artist, which I have been doing ever since. That led to shows like some other projects I worked on, Axe Cop, which was created by a 5-year-old. It's about a cop that fights crime with an axe. Major Lazer, which some of you may be familiar with, the musical artist by Diplo. They had a very psychedelic music and action show that I did a lot of storyboards and directed a few episodes for. Some independent projects I've done as well. This is a music video for the rapper Lil Dicky, featuring Snoop Dogg. Really fun environmental. It's a fun project. You should check it out. What's going on with the thing? Oh, there we go. Goal and the Insatiable. This was a short-lived sitcom on Fox that I actually directed a number of episodes for, kind of like a horror sitcom. Taught me a lot about what's possible, what is humanly possible in terms of taking responsibility for how to handle a project. That's all I can really say about that. But the guys that were the co-showrunners on Goal and the Insatiable were what ultimately led me to this show, which I think a lot of you guys are probably familiar with. if you don't already know, this is Rick and Morty. It's about an alcoholic grandfather who drags his unwilling grandson on adventures across the multiverse. I think that sort of sums it up. I've been a storyboard artist on it for the past 2 seasons. Before I get into it, I just want to share a quick example of what a storyboard artist kind of does. Storyboard artists in animation, we basically create the roadmap of what the show is ultimately going to look like. We work in concert with the writers and do all the planning for, how are the jokes going to land, how are the characters going to enter and exit, what are they going to say. It's the quickest way to draft something. So this is a quick video from, don't play it yet, from Major Lazer. That's just a side-by-side example of what an animatic looks like in comparison to what ultimately a finished cartoon looks like. Okay. Where's the audio? Try it again. Are you plugged in? It should have sound, yeah. There's no sound. I'll sing along to it, yeah. Well, This is maybe a little more dramatic. I can just talk about it as we're doing it. This is a track by Major Lazer called Weed Man. It's a fun track. I wish you could hear it right now. Nothing? No audio? We'll just let it go. Just roll with it. Hopefully the other clips will have video. But you can see on the left, it's kind of like a rough map. We don't have to finish these drawings, which is great because I don't like finishing artwork. I'm far more interested in planning. What do you want to do? Okay. Let's hope the other clips work a little better than that one. So, yeah. So, moving on. I was hired onto season 3 of Rick and Morty, and the very first script I was handed was this thing called Pickle Rick. We had no idea what the hell that meant. It was a real, you know, quite an episode. The thing with working on a show like Rick and Morty is I no longer get to watch it. I have to read it, which is fun in its own way, but you don't really get to experience it the same way as when you kind of like watch it on first blush. But this was kind of, it was a leveling up for me to get onto Rick and Morty. I hadn't really worked on a show like that at that tier before. I was surrounded by a lot of talented people. A lot of really great artists work on that show. And the scene they ended up handing me on my very first day of Rick and Morty was the finale. Act 3 is usually what they call it. It's like the whole kind of culmination of the episode. If you're not familiar with Pickle Rick, it's Rick, who has turned himself into a pickle to avoid family therapy. And he ends up having a bit of a misadventure where he falls into the sewer and builds himself an exosuit out of rat parts and roach parts, and ultimately saves an embassy or just it's a very interesting episode. You should watch it. It's full of metaphors, it's full of insights, it's full of drama, and it's a lot of fun. So this was this is a slide that's a little out of order, but this was the thing that was handed to me my first day. And it was quite an intimidating assignment. To make it more dramatic, I had recently gotten shoulder surgery, and my arm had to be in a brace almost the entire time I was working on this, which kind of upped the stakes just a bit. So I was going to originally put this later, but what I'm going to show first is the what the rest of this talk is more or less going to be about is what I call the boss battle in Pickle Rick, which is Rick versus a character named Jaguar, who's kind of like a gritty mercenary type. I'm going to talk a little bit about my process for how I solved this scene, because it was kind of my first big challenge on the show. I learned a lot doing it. The director on the episode, Anthony Chun, really helped out a lot, taught me a lot along the way. So we're going to watch this first, which is all of my storyboards for the finale, and then we'll rewind to how I kind of got to this point. So is the audio ready? No, it's not. Okay. We have to change computers? I don't know if that's that necessary. I mean, there's not a lot of audio to begin with. Claire, how come your audio worked? I shouldn't have used Google Slideshow. I should have just used PowerPoint like a normal person. Is this going to work? Is my computer going to be any better? I don't think so, but... What number looks like? We're down a ways. Thanks for bearing with us, everybody. Hmm. What's funny is there's not a lot of sound here to begin with. When we get our... I should actually... All right, well, if it's going to go, it's going to go. It's not. All right, well... What we're watching is the finished storyboards for the Pickle Rick boss fight. You can see Rick and Jaguar are shooting at each other. It's very aggressive. They're getting mad. He does a flip. Okay. Maybe next time we'll get lucky. So we're past the stuff I was going to talk about. This is kind of goes on for a bit where Rick and Jaguar kind of taunt each other, and y'all have seen the episode, right? So we'll just... No? We're not going to get audio here? All right, then I'll just stop it. So... Whoa now. Whoa, you're not supposed to see that? I'm lost now. I'm like five slides ahead. How do I get back? So we're not going to get audio for this?
Maybe later.
Later, okay. Trying one more time? Oh yeah, we're gonna watch it a bunch of times.
Problems.
You should know that is an original.
They have my daughter. There's nothing I won't do to see her again.
Yeah, there's lots I wouldn't do to see my daughter, but killing you gets me to her quicker than your derivative bullshit.
I never bullshit, Pickleman. This can only end with one of us dead, and I have never died.
That'll be your downfall, Jaguar. Not being open to new experiences.
Is it done?
Jaguar?
Jaguar couldn't make it.
Do it.
Okay, you win, Pickle Man. I'm unsealing the building.
No thanks. I'm coming for you now.
Pickle Man, there's $100 million worth of bonds in a safe on level 2. I'll give you the combination.
That money belongs to the people.
Shut up and call me a helicopter, you prick! Do we have a deal?
Take that money and give it to Jaguar's daughter when you set her free. Or I'll be visiting you.
Jaguar's daughter is dead.
Huh, so you're a liar.
Jaguar was an animal.
You're an intelligent pickle. We can do business.
I don't think so. See you soon.
Is the helicopter here?
Yes, and the police are on their way. What do we tell them?
Tell them we were robbed.
Hey! Hey! What are you doing? I'm right here!
Solenia.
Okay. So that's roughly about 8 weeks of work with a lot of assistance from Anthony Chun, my director, and Wes Archer, the supervising director, as well as the writers. It's a bit of an organic process, and the process starts... The process starts. with a script. So this storyboarding's hard. There's like, you got to make something from nothing. And what I've, you know, found is a good part of the process is to just get something to watch right away. Because there's literally all you have is a script. If you're lucky, a little bit of audio. That particular sequence that you were watching, not a lot of audio. It's just some gunshots. It's kind of hard to play with that stuff. So I'm just going to read you guys quickly the text that kind of birthed that scene. So it's interior foreign embassy, office, bullpen, day. Jaguar dives and rolls across a span of cubicles, dodging Pickle Rick's laser. Plaster flies everywhere. Office furniture is being sliced to pieces. A long fluorescent light fixture dangles off the ceiling. Both men are equally battered. Pickle Rick pops a smoking battery out of his pack and is about to reload when hail of bullets rains down on him. Pickle Rick runs for cover, swinging and dodging bullets, parkouring off office furniture. Rick fires back his laser as Jaguar leaps across the office, avoiding the beam. Jaguar returns fire, catching Rick in the side, taking a chunk out of the rat suit, going so deep that it sliced all the way down to pickle flesh. Pickle Rick screams in pain. Ah, come on! He loads in a new battery as he scurries along a work counter while Jaguar keeps shooting at him. As he hits the floor, hits the end of a counter, his laser has powered up enough for him to turn to shoot the laser at Jaguar. Jaguar dives, but the laser hits his shoulder, slicing open a big wound. Pickle Rick takes a moment to hide in a cubicle, finally catching his breath. He checks his wound. It's bad. Brine is leaking everywhere. On the other side of the bullpen, hiding behind a desk, Jaguar checks his own wound. His shoulder is torn open. So that's actually pretty descriptive. That's a lot more descriptive than we would normally get in a script. It's a lot to work with, but it's kind of hard to, you know, figure out what is that going to look like when you don't have anything yet to make. What they do give you is a set. If you're lucky, if the design team is on schedule, they'll throw a set at you. But you know, you got to really invent a lot of like what's this going to look like in a space like this. We also, of course, get character designs. Just sharing these for fun, these are some early Pickle Rick designs that the concept artists were working on. He's made this suit out of rat parts and roaches, and there were about probably 25 or 30 different designs. All the character designers got a chance to kind of work on them. But eventually, I think they really wanted to emphasize the pickleness. That was kind of like getting close. We got pretty close at this point. The character designers really do an amazing job on this show, so shout out to you guys. But eventually, you know, they kind of locked it down to something like this, which is what we would get as storyboard artists. You know, we get some background art, we get some character art. We got some art for our villain, just to see what he kind of looks like. And sorry, I just wanted to see where I was at. The process begins. Very sketchy in the beginning. We kind of call these spaghetti drawings, where it's just like barely readable. It's readable to you, the storyboard artist, where you just kind of, as you're reading these scripts, you can kind of start to thumbnail in the margins of the scripts. That's a very common thing that you see. And you just start to kind of find those moments, those kind of crux moments of where characters are going to be, where characters are going to stand, what are the shots going to look like. Some of those get illustrated a bit more. Some of them may last until the end of the episode. Some of them might make it till the final cut, like this shot in the bottom was kind of conceived of kind of early. You know, the idea of like using like wires almost like their jungle or cover or something like that. Whereas where are the characters going to start? I originally started Rick in a cabinet, Jaguar just kind of jumping around, and I was really into this laser cannon. I wanted that laser to feel huge and threatening, so I had this shot of Jaguar just avoiding it. And these things kind of like, you know, emerge as you run along. This is a cool shot I found that never made it to the final cut. I just kind of noticed it when I was putting this presentation together. And like I said before, you really want to get to something as quickly as possible to watch. So what I'm going to show you guys now is the very, very first pass I took at this scene. And then I'm going to talk a bit about how it was improved. So let's see if it has sound.
Ha! Ha! Ah!
Oh, come on!
So, does the job, kind of shows all the beats. It's all kind of there, sort of. Not very exciting, but, you know, it's something to watch because it sort of sets up some geography for you to work with and kind of presents, all right, opportunities for improvement, like where are they? So watching the initial thought, like a very thing that occurred to me kind of early on is this whole thing, in a way, it's kind of a giant battle. Like, Pickle Rick's kind of battling a giant here, like, to him, so why not take advantage of that? Another thing that occurred to me was that, you know, you want to sort of put your protagonist kind of on the back foot in a lot of scenes like this so that they have somewhere to go, and I think having that laser be so intimidating, it almost made Rick from the start seem like a strong character, but you want him to be scared. You want to kind of raise the stakes a bit for him. So with that in mind, I started kind of coming up with more shots for like, okay, what can I do to kind of make Rick feel like he's on the run? Like, you know, you want him to almost not be making it. Like, he may lose this battle. Like, this might be a formidable adversary, which is pretty important, especially in the kind of climactic fight. You know, that's important structurally to the tone of the piece. At a certain point, I had this idea to move Rick inside of a plant, like an office plant, because it served two functions of kind of like, wow, from a wide view, why the heck is there a laser coming out of a plant? And also, if you cut in close, it was almost like Rick as Rambo kind of hiding in the jungle, sort of heightening the game that he's playing with himself. Like, there's, you know, this whole thing is a game to Rick, right? there were a few devices I kind of like stumbled into, half kind of researched. At the time, I was sort of, like I had mentioned, a little overwhelmed by this assignment and looking for ways, anyways. I was just studying other storyboard artists, studying other directors, and one thing I came across is, you know, screen direction, which is a pretty basic rule of storyboarding. Shout out to Wes Archer, who did some of these drawings that I just borrowed from him. He's our supervising director at Rick and Morty. This is a quick depiction of the 180 rule, which, if you guys don't know, when two characters are facing each other, you want to keep the camera on one side of them. Because, especially in animation, if you go on the other side, suddenly things get lost. And because you're working in a fictional space, it's very easy to kind of like suddenly lose that kind of thing. So if characters are facing each other, you want to keep them facing each other. This is a page from a book called Storyboarding the Simpsons Way by Brad Bird. It's actually a PDF. You can download it on the internet. I recommend doing it if anyone's seriously interested in storyboarding. It kind of, the Simpsons kind of like created the Bible, a lot of the groundwork for sitcom television and a basic rule that they kind of like emphasize here is an easy way to remember this. If a character is facing in one direction in one shot, keep them facing that way in every shot, unless you turn them. So what started to happen with Rick being in the plant is I realized we could maybe have Jaguar kind of switching screen direction to maybe almost feel like he's encircling Rick, like he's kind of getting up and getting closer to Rick. I think I had mentioned him wanting to play with Jaguar as a bit more of a giant. And so you can see at the top of the scene, Jaguar is to the left of the screen. Rick's trying to fire at him. Suddenly he's behind him, if you follow this down to the bottom. And now he's on the right. And it's making Rick feel a bit surrounded. Just back to that, take that in. And that continues that trend. Suddenly, you know, Jaguar sneaks up behind him and he's on the other side again. It almost, you know, and suddenly Jaguar is right in Rick's face, up in the threat significantly. Like, suddenly Jaguar is the thing, something to be feared. Rick is now in a pickle. That's what I was going to say there. Another thing that I kind of uncovered around this time was something that I call the slash rule. And this really comes in handy when you're doing any kind of like dynamic storyboards, any kind of action sequence. This is a quick example from Batman the Animated Series, if anyone's familiar with it, that really shows it well. A lot of these shots, basically what the slash rule is, you can have, there's a general thrust to a lot of these actions, to any shot. And that thrust is either a vertical thrust, a horizontal thrust, a diagonal thrust, or the opposite diagonal thrust. And the rule is that you never want to have two of those in a row. So you can see in this Batman sequence, you got these shots are kind of separated by gray boxes. You have a slash, you have a horizontal slash, another diagonal slash, the opposite diagonal slash, opposite again, flat. But if you looked at my very first scene, it's almost all horizontal. It's just like, wow, boring. You know, not really taking any kind of like dynamic opportunities into account. So as this new shot, as this new version was coming together, I really kind of made an effort to figure out ways to kind of incorporate that logic. And another basic storytelling method, I call it the hero's ladder, I think technically is called the Fichtean curve. And you know, I'm sure a lot of you have seen three-act structure charts for how a story goes. It starts here, it comes up to a climax, and then falls back down. That is echoed in these smaller scenes. You want to repeat that as a way to kind of move a story forward, because a bigger story has an arc like that, but also each individual scene has its own arc, because that's the reason you're watching the scene, it's the reason you're watching the story. You want that information to kind of peak at a certain point. And the reason it's called a ladder or sometimes a staircase is as the character is trying to reach a character or a protagonist can be facing a crisis, win that crisis, and then be facing face another crisis and lose, and then that method repeats itself and the drama kind of picks up at each step until ultimately you have a victory or a defeat, or in the case of this episode, a stalemate. So, you know, for example, Rick is in hiding, Jaguar sneaks up on him, Rick escapes. Rick successfully escapes, he's in hiding again, Jaguar sneaks up on him once again, Rick fires back. And it's just these kind of building blocks of a story, which in the beginning, in that very first draft, it's just kind of like sort of flat, characters are firing at each other, nothing really happens. But if you create a bit more of a cause and effect, it sort of unconsciously tells a story as you're watching these scenes. And it's kind of like what I call the hidden language of a storyboard, because you're creating these events to sort of like A, propel the drama, B, propel the narrative. It doesn't have to all be shooting, though. Anthony Chun, my director, had this really great idea to, you know, this is a comedy after all. Let's give Jaguar some life, the villain, and he had this idea to turn it from a shootout to something a bit more acrobatic, where Jaguar does a split and continues firing, and Rick begins doing his own parkour and firing, and ultimately this is when he gets hit. So it goes from a gun battle to a bit of a show-off acrobat battle. And I thought this was really fun. I really wanted to continue to play with it, but at a certain point, you know, you got to finish these things. It's like, enough is enough. So I'm kind of speeding through what ultimately was a lot of kind of trial and error. There's, as I was digging up the files for this, there's probably about 20 drafts of this scene that has evolved and went in a few different directions until it ultimately landed on this level. So to kind of finish things up, I have the finished thing, which we all just watched. It sort of sets up Jaguar a little bit more, but with like a preamble. But yeah, these are all storyboards I did. Hopefully with some of the stuff I just talked about, we'll kind of inform a little more of how the scene was assembled. And let's give it a watch.
You can stay dead to the world and die in this room, or you can kill a pickle for me and earn your freedom.
There is no freedom while your leader breathes. Our country is a prison.
Then Katerina is a prisoner. Perhaps I could arrange her escape as well. She lives, Jaguar.
Where is this pickle?
You should know this isn't personal.
You should know that isn't original.
They have my daughter. There's nothing I won't do to see her again.
Yeah, there's lots I wouldn't do to see my daughter, but killing you gets me to her quicker than your derivative bullshit.
I never bullshit, Pickle Man. This can only end with one of us dead, and I have never died.
That'll be your downfall, Jaguar. Not being open to new experiences.
Is it done? Jaguar?
Jaguar couldn't make it.
Do it! Okay, you win, Pickle Man. I'm unsealing the building.
No thanks. I'm coming for you now.
Pickle Man, there's $100 million worth of bonds in a safe on level 2. I'll give you the combination.
That money belongs to the people.
Shut up and call me a helicopter, you prick! Do we have a deal?
Take that money, give it to Jaguar's daughter when you set her free, or I'll be visiting you.
Jaguar's daughter is dead.
Huh, so you're a liar.
Jaguar was an animal.
You're an intelligent pickle. We can do business.
I don't think so. See you soon.
Is the helicopter here?
Yes, and the police are on the way. What do we tell them?
Tell them we were robbed.
And that's so. Shout out to the writers and everyone else that worked on this show. I feel like everyone's like, you did. It's a team effort, that's pretty much wraps it up. So thank you guys very much for having me. Shout out to Steve-On.
Thanks, Doug. Could we get Claire back up on the stage? We're just going to finish off the first half of the evening just with a short conversation and your chance to ask some questions of Claire and Doug before we take a little bit of a break, and then we head over to the big screen where we're going to have an original score and live performance of over the top of Ghost in the Shell, Innocence. It's not finished. Stop moving. I can see all of you. I'm remembering all your faces. You're not going to get in tomorrow night. I'm going to be the bouncer. Stop. Sit down. Fuck. See? I told you. Asking, opening up to questions. Yeah. Okay, thanks so much for the fantastic presentation, guys. That was really extraordinary. I mean, it's a testament to the crowd that's here, I think, that you both work on some films, some TV that is really dear and precious to so many people. I guess I wanted to start just by talking about what it actually means to work on that kind of IP, the pressure of screwing with someone's childhood fantasies, in the case of Star Wars, Claire, or the pressure of following up season 3, you know, one of the great, what will surely go down as one of the great TV series in modern times. Can you talk a little bit about what it's like working on these projects that have these established worlds in place in some way?
Sure. Oh, this one on? Yeah? Oh, it's working. Hello? Is it working? Sorry. In the case of Star Wars, I was a fan. I saw it as a kid and loved it, the original 3. When I heard it was being filmed and re-brought back with J.J. Abrams, I was on another movie, and I was like, I want to get on that. And thankfully, the supervising art director had seen some of my stuff on something else, and I got the call. And I went to meet them, and I had to keep quiet for quite a few months before I started. So I then had quite a few months of having excitement and anticipation of going to work on it. And when I did, then the pressure hit of, oh God, it's got to be really good. We can't do what the prequels did, and this has got to be much better. And then when we learned about the script and what was going to happen, and with JJ and Disney Lucasfilm, we knew it was in safe hands, and we knew it was going to be good. So it was a lucky combination, but for me, I did feel the pressure because I'm a fan myself, and you get emails. People email you. So
what do they say? Are they screaming at you? Like, how could you kill Han Solo? What are they?
No, not so much. It's at first when people learn that you're on it, they email you to try and find out information, which you can't give. So you just have to stay completely quiet. And as much as I hate ignoring emails, I'm afraid I had to ignore those emails. And then when the film comes out and people love it, you start getting emails saying, can we have that prop? Do you have that thing? Can you? No, we don't get to keep them. They're all locked up. So it's an interesting mix.
I think Rick and Morty is an inspiring place to work because of there's definitely the hype that it has to live up to, which is, you know, a little bit of a something that is challenging to deal with at times. But I think it's a place where a lot of people are just, they want to bring their most vibrant ideas, and the scripts are always inspiring, and the people around you are inspiring, so you just want to do something awesome. Like, it's like, you're just like, if everyone else is bringing their A game, then you want to do the same thing. So I feel like it's a nice energy to ride.
I know you got in a Twitter war. You got in a Twitter war with someone who thought you'd leaked something about evil Morty in season 4. When you actually didn't, yeah. Tell us about that. What happened?
I had done some illustrations around the time of the election that had Morty holding up vote signs, and some people were responding to it in various ways, and they were like, "Well, wouldn't evil Morty want this?" And I just basically responded. I was like, "Well, we'll see." Wink emoji, and that wink emoji got some reporters very excited, like I was insinuating that something was coming, and really I. You know, was not implying anything with that. So, but they love to kind of, any Rick and Morty news that seeps out, they try and make a big thing about.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I was also, I mean, certainly there's pressure from fans trying to find out more. And I mean, every time I talk to you, Douglas, I'm trying to squeeze you for details on season 4 and you're tight as a drum. But I guess I'm also thinking in terms of the world building of these projects, that there's an established canon. There's already rules to that world. I know, like, Rick and Morty is extraordinarily faithful in terms of its continuity from episode to episode. And Star Wars, there's a huge list of things that you can't do. And at certain points, as designers, you make decisions whether to go with the canon or to break that canon. I guess I wonder if there are moments where you've been faced with the continuity of producing more of the same versus the risk of trying something new.
In the case of Star Wars, I think it was a very early conscious decision from Lucasfilm and Disney and JJ to go with the language of the original three movies, which is it's junk. It's stuff that. They had no money when they made the first Star Wars. They made it from found objects and found things lying around. And then they did the prequels, and they ignored all that. And they did this whole visual effects world of... if you look at the screens in the prequels, they're all very digital, and there's lights everywhere. But if you look at the originals, it's a little bit of tape and a button. So we really made the conscious decision to go back to the little bit of tape and the button, just to be faithful, and it's a language that works better.
I mean, Rick and Morty does have kind of a regimented language, but there's always opportunity to stretch it. And I think they do welcome that. We sort of have a little bit of a balancing of a cinematic language versus a more traditional sitcom language. A lot of times comedy just works better in a sitcom language, and some of the board artists, we really like to push kind of more dramatic stuff when we can. Sometimes it gets too dramatic. Sometimes we'll be able to sneak that kind of stuff in. But I think there's always, what's great about Rick and Morty is there's always opportunity to pitch. So if you have ideas and you want to bring to the table, you can bring them there.
Yeah, and I wonder, like, in that sense, at what point some of these decisions are made? Because in many ways, both of you are environment designers. I mean, you started out as a background artist, Doug, and Claire, literally, you build the environments, the scenes, the spaces in which action takes place. I wonder if you could talk a little bit more. I know you went into some detail with it, Doug, in your presentation, but the translation from words on a page and a script, which oftentimes is kind of vague in terms of that entire world building and that entire environment, and talk about how you actually start that process, whether it's looking at references, looking at other films, or previous things in the canon, doing sketches, talking to the director, like how are you actually inventing these fictional spaces? Because, I mean, here we sit in Stroker, which is in design and architecture school in many ways, and for the most part, this is the design and architecture of the screen. And you guys are designers of those worlds. And literally, it's about giving life to the page and creating space from that page. Can you talk a little bit about how that starts to work in your process?
I mean, we get the script, and we read the script, and then the director will have ideas, the studio will have ideas. There's a production designer who knows exactly what they want. And then they send off, we have researchers, and they look into various things that have been mentioned. And then from there, we start to come up with options. Normally, you know, 3, 4, or 5 options, put them under the director's nose, and they start to hone in on something. Or they don't, and you have to go back to the drawing board. But we tend to get the look pretty early on. These may change later as a script changes, but as soon as we've kind of nailed our look, we then start talking to storyboard artists, showing them, hey, look, this is our set, this is what we kind of want, and also previs artists, and they start doing the animatics and previs around our set rather than something that they're making up, because then it doesn't relate to what we're going to do. And then the director can see things in the storyboard and the previs that will exist for him. Because sometimes if they've come on it before us, then they've created a space and the director's like, I want that. And the designer's like, maybe we could do this, but they've already got it in their head. So we try and get in early as well.
The storyboard team, well, I've always been intrigued by how much story can be contained in an environment. And so having a background in background design, that was a lot, that's a lot of what we would do is like, what's the contents of this room? How would it support the characters that live there? The things that are gonna happen. And, you know, so as a storyboard artist, we don't get to do that so much, but occasionally as we're, you know, building a scene, as the puzzle of a scene kind of comes together, we may realize, like, you know, what would really heighten this moment is if this prop was made out of stone instead of wood, or small details like that, that, you know, because you're sort of thinking about the story, and then not only that, but the functional mechanics of, like, okay, well, if this big block is going to fall down, like, you know, shouldn't be made of stone or something like that. So there's an opportunity to tweak environment and how it sort of enhances a story when you're working with environment from the story perspective as a storyboard artist.
But I guess I'm also thinking about, you know, so much of the Pickle Rick episode leverages a whole history of 80s and 90s action films, you know, like... whether it's Rambo storming an Afghani prison, or like peeking through the jungle, and, you know, it harks back to, I'm thinking about, you know, scenes from Schwarzenegger's Predator and and all of these films that and even in Star Wars, there's both the references of the existing films, but there's also extraordinary references from real places and real landscapes that feature so heavily, both as bases for set extensions, but also like live environments that are just shot in camera. So I guess I'm wondering there, like, where you're starting with some of those references, and what if there are any examples of how that might work? Because in many ways, you're leveraging from either existing cultural canon or the real world, and starting to remake stories and reimagine new places within those contexts, right?
I mean, the putting Pickle Rick in the plant is a perfect example of that. I mean, it's obviously a Die Hard-esque kind of Rambo-inspired character, and that moment just really served it well. I think a similar echo was happening when he's hiding behind the wires in the computer. Like, it's just like coverage of foliage, and Rick and Morty in general is a very postmodern show in that way. It has a lot of cultural. Its building blocks are made out of other things, and its environment is a great way to take those opportunities. Same thing in character design. I mean, all over the place. It's just like anywhere you can kind of like riff on those cultural touchstones just makes the work that much more relatable and elastic.
In terms of film, I guess it varies on movie to movie. It's normally quite clear what kind of environment they're looking for. And then we have a team of location scouts who literally go around the world, and they will find things that either look similar or could be made to look similar. And if that doesn't work, then we'll just build it. And it's quite black and white like that for us.
Yeah, and I'm also thinking maybe this is particularly a Star Wars kind of question, but there's a really unique world that's been created across the length of all these 9 films now, and there's particular rules that for the most part have made sense, but then really stand out when they're broken. Like you said, the rules of the screen. I mean, there's also like I don't think there's ever any wheels in Star Wars.
No, everything floats.
Sorry?
Everything floats.
Everything floats, and until episode 8, there was never.
I didn't work on 8.
Okay.
Just to be clear. Fine.
Well, maybe you should have. In episode 8, there's paper for the first time. In the entire Star Wars canon, there's never paper until we see the books in the Jedi Temple on the island. I mean, is there like a secret Star Wars rule book that you must follow?
I mean, we kind of thought there was on 7 and stuff. There's never really a language in Star Wars that you see written down. If it is, it's very kind of distant and stuff. So.